Welcome, my name is Jean Ray McGowan. I'm president of the Georgetown Historical Society, and it is my pleasure to welcome the Georgetown Conservation Commission here. This is their program this evening, but we are pleased to be able to provide the facility for programming for all kinds of organizations here in Georgetown, and even sometimes outside of Georgetown. So my job, besides welcoming you, is to share with you a couple quick things about the Historical Society, and then I will hand it off to Maureen, okay, get my cues here, and she will introduce the speaker this evening and describe what's on the back table if you haven't seen it already. This is a very special year for Georgetown. For those of you who don't know, we are going to be celebrating the official 300th birthday of Georgetown in June of this year. And I have taken the opportunity of a captive audience to print out page 8 of our upcoming Georgetown tie, which is not yet put back from the printer. But page 8 shows you the programming that we will be doing so far this year that we have lined up, and so I will leave these on a couple of chairs along the way, and you're more than welcome to take a copy. And for those of you who don't get the Georgetown tie, I invite you to grab a membership card and envelope on your way out and a free sample of the current tie and see if it's something that might be of interest to you. One of the major funding sources for the Historical Society is your membership in GHS, and for that, in addition to supporting us, you also get the tie 6 times a year. So we invite you to join us. I always encourage people to stand up and say a little something that they know of another event that's coming up in the next few weeks that's going on in Georgetown. Is there anything we need to make an announcement about before I turn this over to Maureen? Okay. Thank you very much for coming. Thanks for being here at the Historical Society. And now Maureen Stanton is going to tell you about tonight's program.
So thanks everyone for coming out on this beautiful spring night. My name is Maureen Stanton. I'm a member of the Georgetown Conservation Commission, and we're sponsoring the event tonight. We're very fortunate to have in our community Dr. Ananda Cole, who has a long list of accomplishments and experience in healthcare, medical research, and advocacy, including 20 years as a general internist. It was very hard to actually cut down her giant resume to make an introduction, but I have to hit the highlights. Dr. Cole has been on the faculty of Tufts, Brown University, and Harvard Medical School, and is currently a professor of medicine at the University of New England College of Osteopathic Medicine, Center for Excellence in the Neurosciences. She's the founder and principal of Shared Decision-Making Resources, whose focus is to help patients and healthcare providers make decisions that reflect their personal circumstances, risk factors, goals, and preferences. As a pioneer in this field, she lends her expertise to the international Patient Decision Aid Standards Collaboration, the FDA's Risk Communication Advisory Committee, the Brookings Institute, and the National Institute of Health. Dr. Cole has worked on other infectious diseases, including the Rabies Advisory Committee to the Massachusetts Department of Public Health, working on strategies to reduce the rabies epidemic among raccoons there. And she's presented her talk about tick-borne illnesses to many groups, such as the Southern Maine Sea Kayaking Network and several wellness groups. Somehow, with all these accomplishments and responsibilities, she still has time to bake cookies, which are educational to her cookies, so be sure to look at those in the back. And please join me in giving a very warm welcome to Dr. Nananda Cole.
Anybody else to have those experiences. So this is the result, this is why I talk
Okay, so that being said, okay, Lyme disease has been in the news a lot. But when I look around and people are hiking and doing things, I don't see people actually dressed in appropriately. I am dressed appropriately. This is not a fashion statement. Those of you who know me and actually may well be a fashion statement. I'm going to start with a different way of looking at this. Let's start by how to get Lyme disease. Okay, there are so many ways you can get Lyme disease. How many people in this room have already had Lyme disease? Okay, how many have had it more than once? Okay. And how many have know somebody in their family or friend with that Lyme disease? Yeah. So somebody who's a Maine guy, who was in my gave talk earlier, said that he had just got back from a very painful experience with Lyme disease. Because it can be really unpleasant. And said he was at a meeting with the Maine guys, and he asked people there how many had Lyme disease. He said more than half an answer. This was a couple years ago. Rates were going, it's getting more and more prevalent every year. The point I want to make is if you don't take precautions, you will get Lyme disease. Even if you've had it before, you'll get it again. So just pay attention. So how to get Lyme disease? So many ways. This is how I got it, foraging for mushrooms. One of the primary care doctors, and that's Charles Duncan, a naturalist. I assume they were actually aware of protection. On the coast, anywhere where there's high growing bushes or shrubs around the side, you can get Lyme disease. Hiking. Biking, as you know, on the road. If you spend any time outdoors, you will be exposed to ticks. We don't have any signs here in Georgetown. I don't think. Do we have any tick signs in Georgetown? Yeah. Now the bottom line is, if you're active outdoors and don't take precautions, you will likely get infected or reinfected. And this is why the ticks outnumber us. Most of them are diseased. They wait for us in line with and they're really much smarter than us. If you look at like how many sensors and everything, they really have, they're very equipped, they evolved to find us. And they're just really picky. But the good news is if you take precautions, you can avoid infection. Okay? And it's not like there's one thing. So the key thing is if you take precautions, there's a variety of little things you can do to really reduce your risk close to zero. But I'm going to talk just for a minute, why don't people take precautions? People know, everyone's heard about this, but people don't dress like this when they're outdoors. And I was thinking about that, I think it's cognitive dissonance. Cognitive dissonance is this mental stress caused when you holding two or more contradictory beliefs. Okay, so people hold the belief nature is good, being outdoors is healthy. That's a happy thought. There's also this bad thought that so how do we deal with this? We tend to just like wishful thinking. It is a messy cue cartoon. My desire to be well informed is currently at odds with my desire to remain sane. We just don't think about it. Okay. Now, part two, I want to let everybody know that we are, if you live anywhere on this island or in this vicinity, anywhere on the coast of Maine, you are living in a high-risk area. So here's what you need to know. Lyme disease was reported for residents in all counties in Maine for the first time in 2014. It's been marching up, it's named Lyme from Lyme, Connecticut, but it's been sort of marching up the coast. And marching further north, and last year was, 2014 was the first year. And the entire coast, red is bad on this, that's all you need to know. The darker the color, the higher the percentage, the rate of infected ticks. And you can see red, we're somewhere, where are we, Bob? We're somewhere around here.
You're in Georgetown.
We're in Georgetown. We're in Maine. We're somewhere on this coast. It's all red. Doesn't matter. Okay? High risk. Okay. Now, we're talking about Lyme disease, but it's really important to know that there are several diseases that ticks harbor. And it's important to know that because different types of ticks harbor, different stages of ticks will harbor different types of different diseases. So Lyme disease is one that we'll talk about. It's caused by a bug called Borrelia burgdorferi. And this is the most, it's the most common of tick-borne diseases. It's very serious, but it is treatable if you get it treated early. Anaplasmosis it's more, the symptoms are unmistakable. You feel really sick. Severe acute illness, fever, it lowers your white count and it lowers your platelets. So I was lucky to have both of these together, which makes it particularly difficult for your immune system to do anything because one of them attacks your white, actually lives in your white blood cells. And so that actually sort of kills your immune system. So when you have these two together, you feel really, really badly. There's another bug, a bacteria, babesiosis. It's called Nantucket fever because it was in Nantucket several years ago. Fever and anemia. Generally, if you have a spleen, then it's something that's self-limiting. If you don't have a spleen, it will kill you. So if anybody in here doesn't have a spleen or is immunocompromised, you have to be really careful about this. There's not really a treatment for it. Powassan disease, this is incredibly rare, however, it has arrived, and it actually killed a woman. I heard she got bitten in Georgetown, but I don't know if that's true, but she's in the Camden area. But there's only been a few cases of this, but it's a virus, very rare, but a 15% mortality rate, and it kills you pretty quickly, so that's kind of scary. And this is one I just learned about. Recently, that it was here. Rob Smith is the co-director of the tick-borne lab from the medical center. He said that he was just looking at all of the serum from people that got bitten by ticks in Maine, and found that this new Borrelia miyamotoi, which causes a type of relapsing fever, which is like Lyme but much worse. And has no rash, so it's a little trickier. But actually, he said that was 1/5 the prevalence of Lyme disease in samples here. So from something that was really rare, I guess it flew over from Japan in a bird, it was carried by birds. But this is now something else that is in our ticks. It causes a pretty severe illness. That's five. It's not good. So I'll talk about Lyme disease. They often are concurrent because they all these diseases are the little white mouse, white-footed mouse. There's a little rodent. They're actually harbor. If they get bitten by an infected tick, they actually harbor that disease. If they get bit by another tick that harbors another disease, they will harbor that. So these can be multiply infected rodents. And so the ticks can have two or three of the different diseases. It's not like pick one, and they often are concurrent. Okay, early symptoms of Lyme disease. The reason it's important to know a little something about this is so that if you have early symptoms, you will need to get treated. So it's important that you educate yourself, because you also may need to educate your doctor, because it's often misdiagnosed early on or mistreated. So it resembles a viral symptom. Think about something like the flu. If you catch the flu's not going around, and you've been out in the woods or out in a tick area, which will go over. Think about that. Most will have a rash, but will not know it. So if you wait for the rash to appear, if you see a rash that appears, you want to think about it. But you don't want to wait for a rash, because most times people don't see the rash. And the reason is because you get bitten, say, in your scalp or somewhere else where you can't see, or where the sun doesn't shine, you're not going to see a rash. So even though there's a rash, you don't want to wait until you see a rash. Most people who have this don't, a few actually recall the tick bite, but most don't even recall, because when the ticks bite you, they actually insert a little anesthetic into the side, so you don't feel it. So it's not like a mosquito. And when I say they're smarter than us, I mean that very seriously. Most recover rapidly and completely. The sooner you get treatment, the easier treatment. If you get treated right away, it's 2 weeks of taking pill twice a day. It's that easy. If the longer you wait, the longer the duration of treatment, and potentially you may need IV antibiotics when you do it in the hospital. But early treatment is highly effective and not difficult. If it's untreated, if you have this and it's untreated, 60% of people will develop persistent arthritis. It tends to hit the knee. But that's the most people will have that. 10% will have neurologic involvement, facial nerve palsy, it can be very painful. And 5% will have cardiac. Basically, it will block the electrical transmission in the heart. So, you know, you don't want to mess with this. This slide, tick-borne diseases. The four most common, Lyme, anaplasmosis, babesiosis, also mentioned Boston. The reason I'm showing this slide is just look at these are the, where there's a the more X's, the more pluses, it means the more more frequently that symptom is associated with it. So this says Lyme, the most common rash is commonly found in Lyme disease. Fatigue is commonly found. Muscle aches, joint aches, less common, but it's still there. You don't see malaise, restlessness, and nausea. These are the symptoms for Lyme. These are the symptoms for anaplasmosis, fatigue, muscle aches. Okay, how many people here in the last 2 weeks have experienced some fatigue, muscle aches, or joint aches, or headache? Okay, so you see that there's a diagnostic problem here, okay? Because, you know, from the doc's point of view, people come in and say, well, I've had this, you know. And these are what we call non-specific symptoms. Could be caused by a bunch of stuff. This is why it's really hard to make a diagnosis. So, and it's not going to be because so many patients come in having some combination of these symptoms. You're not going to be thinking, aha, you got bit by a tick. Your doctor may not know that you're living in a tick-infested area. They may not know that you like to go foraging for mushrooms or hunting for deer or whatever it is that gets you outdoors. So you have to put two and two together, maybe tell the story a little bit. If you have these symptoms, say, by the way, this happened 2 weeks after I was out in the woods doing something and I might have gotten bit by ticks or I've been finding ticks or, you know. So just make sure when you think about these symptoms, none of these things are going to be automatic, you know, oh, Lyme disease for a doctor. Okay, and this is, I want to address one of their most common misperceptions, is this idea of chronic Lyme disease. People get Lyme disease and chronic Lyme disease confused. Lyme disease is a real medical entity. Chronic Lyme disease is not a real medical entity. It's kind of a messy term that is not really precisely defined. So what it is that up to 13% of patients who are treated for Lyme disease will later on have some persistent fatigue, pain in the muscles or their bones, and difficulty concentrating or remembering after a year after they've had Lyme disease. Okay, and so in the lay press, it's called chronic Lyme disease. There's actually it's not a medical term. What it is that there are some people who, after they've been exposed to the antibiotic, there's an autoimmune response. And so you may have some active ongoing stuff. Some people were not adequately treated the first time around. So while we don't necessarily know why there are these a small number of people who have these long-lasting symptoms, we do know that for people who think they have chronic Lyme disease, that there have been studies looking at when you give them long-term antibiotics for a year, they don't get better, their underlying symptoms don't get better, and we also know that they get really sick from the antibiotics because these antibiotics over a year cause a lot of serious symptoms. So whatever it is, and sometimes it's an undiagnosed symptom, sometimes it's people who are in early stages of MS, because when people get Lyme disease, you know, things happen and people get diagnosed. So anyway, it's an area of confusion, but the thing to remember is that if you have Lyme disease, if you get treatment early on, 95% of the time, you're going to be completely fine, you know, forever. A lot of people think they have a current Lyme disease after just getting bitten again and again and again. Because if you don't change your behaviors, you don't really develop any kind of immunity, so you can get reinfected. The Lyme rash is another source of confusion. Okay, because theoretically it's there, but because you can't, you know, often the ticks like to go for places that are like moist and damp, they like armpits, navels, hair, scalp, you know. you're not going to see it. And the other thing is that people, there's this characteristic rash. It's called a target lesion. Has anyone heard about this target lesion? This is a target lesion. Basically, it looks like a target because you've got red on the outside and clearing on the middle. Okay, so it looks like a target. This looks like a target. But what happens with these rashes, they start out small. So they start out like a little, you know, a little pinprick with a tick bit you. If it's an area you can see. They start out really small. And initially, they're just uniformly red. They're not painful. They're not itchy. If it's painful and itchy, that's not Lyme. It's not a Lyme rash. Okay, that's why they spider bite. But it starts that little thing, and then it just gets gradually bigger and bigger. And only when it gets like 5 to 7 centimeters, will it start to clear in the middle. So if you have a little rash and it's uniformly red, it could, I mean, you're not going to see a target lesion little. Those are big by the time they have that clearing. Okay? Usually the first one is at the site where you were bitten, so there'll either be a little necrotic, like, you know, a little dead skin or a little blister in the middle, and then a little rash in the skin. The thing to do, if you have a little rash and you're not quite sure about it, you want to have a little mark or a mark, you know, Sharpie at home. What you do, if you're worried about it, a little circle, what you do is you just put, you know, get your little mark, you know, you mark right around the outside of the perimeter of that rash with your, so let's see, with this one, you would mark the outside perimeter of the redness. And then you just go back and check 2 hours later or 3 hours later, because it expands. And now, if it's a spider bite, it's not going to expand, it's just going to gradually fade. But if this was a Lyme rash, it would be getting, you know, it would be expanding beyond the margin. So you use your marker, and you can get some reassurance pretty quickly. If it's not expanding, it's not Lyme. If it's a rash that you're worried about. Okay. And then often, if you miss the first rash, these are just icky pictures, because I feel like I'm a doctor, I'm allowed to show icky pictures. So basically the first rash is usually at the site, but often that's missed, so sometimes it didn't get disseminated. So the Lyme disease is disseminated through the blood, so it'll go through the blood and get the rest of, you know, other places in the skin, so you'll have these really big areas, you have multiple areas of icky rashes. Again, they don't feel warm to the touch, they're not itchy, they're not painful. They just look itchy. Okay. And this is just deciphering rashes. The only point here is that there's a lot of things cause rashes. Spider bites cause a lot of rashes. Insect bites, you know, dry skin. There's so many things. Ringworm. There's a gazillion things that cause rashes. Just because you have a rash doesn't mean it's a tick bite. And now you don't have a towel, right? You just put a circle around the outside and you just wait a couple of hours. And you'll have a pretty good idea whether it's a Lyme rash or not. And if it's itchy or painful, it's not Lyme. Anaplasmosis, I just want to mention, this is because there are any hunters, must be hunters in Georgetown. Yeah. So transmission is thought to be the same through deer ticks. But here's also a question, I don't know if it's true or not. So there's an article that said there were apparently some hunters that got people that got exposed to the blood of a deer, an infected deer, but weren't actually exposed to a tick. And they were pretty sure they had no exposure to a tick. So just be careful when you're touching the blood. It's just an area of an uncertainty. Now, ticks have to be attached for a couple of days. One, you know, typically people think that a deer tick, you know, be attached for like 3 days to get a Lyme disease, 2 or 3 days. Anaplasmosis, one day, is good enough for the tick to infect you, so that's something to be careful about. Babesiosis, I just want to know that this has been one of the tick-borne diseases. These are global phenomena. The rhetoric is worse. And you look, so this is areas where they've got some level of infection with babesiosis. But look where all the red zones are. Right here. Lucky us. Okay, and Powassan virus. This was the lovely artist who died 100 years ago from Powassan. And she was perfectly healthy. This notion that if you're healthy and you're live a good life and you eat good, that will protect you from these things. It won't. These
the Lyme disease and this Borrelia miyamotoi. They're called spirochetes. Example, in the corkscrew. In the corkscrew, it's a corkscrew virus. So basically, when they get into your system, it drills in. So it's a pretty deadly thing. It's just like syphilis, you know. I mean, they're closely related to the three of them are the same Yankee family. So this is Borrelia miyamotoi, which I mentioned earlier was the newcomer to the ticks in this area. It flew in from Japan, like a bird. And it was first reported last year, just a year or two ago, in the medical literature. And again, now it's found in the tick for the people in this area. The time between tick bite and symptoms is about 12 to 16 days, which is roughly around Lyme disease. It's somewhere between 3 days and 30 days, somewhere around that interval. So it's around the same. But there's no rash whatsoever with this. You have really high fevers. This is like not just like a little. You have high fevers, chill sweats. You feel like you're going to die. This is a really bad influenza. A quarter of people end up in the hospital very quickly. So you know, there's no doubt that you're feeling sick. However, I mean, this is something that most docs don't know about yet. Partly, even though the lab has found that they haven't published their results yet. So your doctors are probably not going to know that if you have symptoms that look like this, you know, they may not be aware that the Borrelia miyamotoi is now actually very active. It's called a BMD, so it's a relapsing fever, but it's BMD, Borrelia miyamotoi disease. That's not a working name. I mean, this was not a good name. Okay, now, this Lyme disease is on the upswing. So, yeah, there's a lot of people who are like, you know, I've been doing this all my life and I never got sick. Right? Well, there's a lot of things you could have been doing all your life here and not got sick, because Lyme disease wasn't really here until, you know, 2000. You know, it's been marching up the coast. And so this shows the rate of Lyme disease in Maine from 2000 to 2014. There's no data. I don't know what happened. There's no data for last year at all. I can't figure out why. There's nothing that's been reported. But the trend is assuming it's gone higher. I don't know if they ran out of money to monitor this or what. But anyway, look at the trend over the years. It's going up. These dips are probably reporting biases. So this is the rate, and this is the actual number of cases. And the estimate is that about, for every case that is verified, there's probably about 10 times more that are not verified. Because people have to actually go and have all the lab testing. And this compares Maine to the United States as a whole. Maine is in blue, so Maine was lower rate of U.S. as a whole, but then look, we win. We are much higher than the United States. We're really good at this. And this shows it's not just Lyme disease. This is Lyme, anaplasmosis. This is the rate over time. 2010 is the last 4 years that we have data. Going up. On this one, the last data is in July. But I mean, the trend. This is not a good trend. Okay, now this shows that each dot represents a case. So this is 2001, and just look at the pattern. As far as I can tell, this is Maine. Is that correct? This is Maine. We're somewhere around here. Anyway, just look at. You can see what's happening over time. Let's do this again. 2001. Now it's going more, and now 2014. You can just see it's deep. There's more of it, and it's spreading up the coast. This is looking at different counties. And it basically shows this is 2004, 2008, and then this is more recent. You can see initially, again, darker is bad. It means you have a higher density, higher rate of Lyme. And here it was only the southern county had the high rate. And now, through 2009-13, it marched up. And this is the latest that I could find this figure for, 2013. And just this whole area is high now. This is probably a combination of global warming. We have good, healthy deer population. And the cold weather kills the ticks, and we don't have as much cold weather to kill them. Lyme by county, if you look at mid-coast, again, bigger is worse, and mid-coast, we have the worst, we have the highest rate. So again, Maine is in bad shape. We are in the absolute highest part of Maine. It's right where we live. So who's at risk? Pretty much everybody is. Men have a little bit of higher rate than women. I think this doesn't mean there's more susceptibility. This probably means that men probably are outdoors a little bit more, or maybe men are doing basic checks as women, or I don't know. And this is by age group. This is another interesting thing. In Maine, the highest rate of Lyme disease, this is looking over time, let's look at the most recent year, the highest rate is this light green. That's 5 to 14, the arrows go at this place. 5 to 14, that's the highest rate are the kids, okay? And the next highest rate are the 65-year and older. Big Bob's theory was that the older people are there because they can't see the ticks. I think it's because you can't reach them. I don't know. We more know here, right? or maybe that we have more time to be outdoors. But I mean, these are all pretty high. But I mean, the kids and the older people, and then the next rate here is a 45 to 64. Now, nationally, this is actually the highest rate. So in Maine, we have a little bit of we're a little different. I think it makes sure we do have a little bit of older people who are retiring a little on the coast. I don't know. Anaplasmosis, this is basically making the same point, is that this is the incidence, you know, the darker red is worse. It's here in Wisconsin. You know, these are not national, these are not things that are affecting the whole country. We're dead. We're right in the middle of it. Okay, so what are the odds that if you find a deer tick, which there are a lot of them around, you find what's the odds that they're affected? Pretty high. This is at some point it was 55% in New Jersey. In Maine, it's 50 to 70% of the
okay. That's deer ticks.
The deer ticks are effectively Lyme, right? Not the deer. The deer we don't hear about the deer because the deer don't actually pass on the disease.
Nor the dog ticks or the wood.
What's that?
Nor the dog ticks or the wood ticks.
No, we don't care about the other ticks. No, I mean, I'm sure dog owners do, but we don't. And a third of those are also infected with anaplasmosis or babesiosis. And now the latest is a fifth of those are also infected with this latest Japanese variety of relapsing fever. Okay? So one-fifth, because this is one-fifth of the tick that the people didn't have evidence of this. So we've got a lot. Okay, so it's important to be able to identify a tick.
They're fuzzy.
So this is a
tough.
Okay. So there are a lot, I think there are hundreds of ticks out there. I think in Maine there are like, I don't know, and more than a dozen, possibly 80. I don't know, there's a whole bunch of different ticks out there. But the other ticks don't carry these diseases. There's only one kind of tick that carries Lyme disease and all these other ticks. All these other diseases. It's this, the black-legged tick, Ixodes scapularis, which when I went to medical school, it was called Ixodes damni, which means damn tick. And it's the only thing I remember from medical school, and actually it's also the only Latin phrase. Ixodes damni, and Ixodes means a hard shell tick. I guess ticks are like lobsters, they come in hard shells and soft shells, so Ixodes means a hard shell. So you learn some Latin today. So the thing with ticks, it's kind of like identifying birds, that they look different when they're different stages of their life. And so it's real important to figure what they are. So this is the female, this one, it's a female tick that is not engorged. So either they're either like normal or engorged. There's nothing in between, you know? And this is a nymphal tick that is engorged. Okay, this is a head of a pin. This is tiny. So this is a nymphal tick. This is a female tick. I'm not sure. I think this is the female tick, this is the male tick, and this one that has six legs, this is a larval tick. Keep an eye out for the larval ticks. So ticks are not insects, they're actually in the spider family, arachnid family, because they have eight legs, except when they're larval, which basically have six legs. So anyway, so here's a larval, a nymph, and again, a male and the female. Okay? The females are the ones you have to worry about. The males will bite too, but I don't know if they're the big spread. Okay, now, so again, a lot of dog ticks out there, especially if you have dogs. This is a dog tick, and this is a deer tick. They're not that much difference in size. And when they get engorged, an engorged female tick can look a lot. One of these is an engorged tick, deer tick, and one is an engorged dog tick. Okay? Hard to tell the difference. When they're engorged, they lose all these wonderful markings. This is how they look when they're hungry and unfed. And this is actually a nymph, but this is another one. But she's in the woods. For the
she's not wearing right clothing.
So we're gonna figure out which one is which. I believe this is the dog tick because it's got this funny little thing. But once they're engorged, you know, whatever the animal should have for identifying them, all messed up. Again, larval, nymph, male. This is misidentified. See, this is actually from textbook and it's misidentified. This is the female. You can't trust everything you read. Okay. The females are bigger than the males, and the females have the red back on them. And here's the various sizes. But look at when they're engorged. This is the female unengorged. This is the female engorged. It's like an egg.
Oh my gosh.
You know? But how are you going to tell once they're engorged what that was? Okay. So here's an unfed, and here's an engorged. Okay, totally different. Yeah, it's disgusting, isn't it? and my first encounter with ticks was when my daughter was, I don't know, she was 12 or 13, and she had a tick under her armpit. And all she was doing was screaming, take it up, hold still. I mean, they are really disgusting. And you can't identify them when you're like this. You know, so it's really icky. Okay, and this is a female with an egg. Yes. So after they eat, then they digest for a while, and they lay the eggs. There are like a couple thousand eggs, and the eggs just like sit in the leaves where they left them until they hatch, and then they start crawling kind of big trouble. Okay, so here we are. Which one? How many people think this is the deer tick? Okay. You think, which one is a dog tick? The one on the right? This one, dog tick. Dog tick?
No.
Wrong glove.
Yeah. I mean, this is, so I can't give you this out. And it's what I hear. So here's, again, so the thing is, when you see them, I mean, I brought tick spoons for everybody. When you take these things off, they're kind of mangled. I mean, you don't get to see the full pristine. This is the thing, this is the key thing for a dog tick, this little pattern they have there. But of course, when you're trying to like remove them, that gets kind of squished. But anyway, that's what makes it a dog tick. This is not nice. Okay. I want to tell you a little bit about the secret life of deer ticks, because these are things you need to know to avoid encountering these guys. They live in forests, savannas, I'm not sure what a savanna is, grasslands and shrublands. After they attach to a host for a few days to weeks, depending on if it's a female or a male, they drop off, spend weeks to months digesting your blood. Then they molt to the next stage, and then they repeat the process to a different. So they need a blood meal. They basically have just a blood meal at each stage to be their thing. The adult ticks will reproduce and die after their blood meal. This is a 2-year process for ticks. The reservoir, which means where all the diseases are, and for Lyme and other diseases, are in the chip, the mice, the chipmunks, and the small mammals and bird, but not the deer. So the deer don't actually carry the disease. They just, the deer, when they spread the disease, they just feed and spread the ticks that carry the disease. So they're essential to the lifestyle, but they don't actually harm the disease. Okay. I like this figure because it shows, so basically those, remember that ugly egg mass? Those egg mass will turn into these little six-legged larvae. The larva will find a little critter, you know, chipmunk, mouse, some tiny rodent. They will sit on that critter for a couple of days or to a week until they have enough blood. Then they'll drop off and then they'll metamorphize. I mean, that's not the right word, but they'll do something until they turn into a nymph. So they grow an extra two legs, which is pretty neat. And then they'll wait for another host. So they've had one meal so far turned into this, and they sit around and wait for some sucker to come along that they can actually suck on, and then they bite this guy, and then they drop, once they have that meal, they drop off again, and then they wait while they're digesting that, and then they turn into an adult. And this happens often during the winter, so this can happen right before winter, they'll be sitting in the snow on the winter pile. And then they emerge as the adults. At that point, they're looking for something bigger. They're looking for the deer. Okay? And that's when they jump on the deer, and there's like this big orgy going on with the deer, and that's where the male and the female ticks meet each other, mate, and then the engorge, and then the female drops off, lays her eggs, and the whole thing starts to work. This is a two-year cycle. And this shows, so that was just the general idea. There was just, you know, a few meals in there, you know, over, basically eats four times in 2 years. And this just shows you the seasons. They start the eggs here in the spring, summer is when the larvae come out, and then the nymphs come back out in the spring, and then the adults come out later. I'll show you this. This initially was confusing because this is January. When it's really cold, the ticks are not active. It's freezing and below, you don't have to worry about ticks. If it's above freezing, I think it's about 35 or 37 degrees, the ticks are out and about. You've got adults out. Initially, you've got adults now, March. You've got the adult ticks are out. But soon, the nymphs from last year's cycle are going to be, those nymphs are going to be coming out in the middle of June, the middle of the summer. And then towards the end of summer, the larvae will peak. And then when they're going back out again, the adults, before the late fall, the adults are back out. So the thing is, it used to matter because the larvae weren't infected. So it used to be, well, there was kind of have like a little bit of a window in here. Now the larvae are infected with this new Japanese, the relapsing fever. So now basically the only thing you need to take away from this is the entire, if it's not freezing out, there's something out there that's diseased. I mean, they're basically from February to December, they're out there. And the thing is, the adults tend to hang on, they tend to be on higher stuff. The larvae, they only have six legs, so they can't crawl very high. They're on the ground, they're coming out of eggs. So they tend to be in lower grass, which means if you focus on, in these seasons, you know, the end of August, fall, if you actually will treat your feet and your socks, they're not going to get very high because they're just larvae. So you can sort of target where you're going to go. Now, of course, if you're doing stuff like digging around the leaves or, you know, gardening, mushroom burning, that's most of us do. You know, you want to dress appropriately and wear a hat when you dive in, so you don't have a head. But basically, there's always something out unless it's really cold. So you need to also understand more about the behavior of these ticks. They don't hop. They stand on their back legs. They're kind of like, you know, like, so you can demonstrate as a yoga. This is like something, what would be the yoga?
It's our latest pose.
Latest pose, isn't it? So they basically stand there. Remember, they had one meal, they've got like 4 months to wait for somebody to come by. They find a blade of grass, they climb out to the end, and they just sit there for months waiting. And they can sense you coming, okay? They have their front legs outstretched. They can tell you're coming because of the vibrations of your walking. They can sense carbon dioxide. They can sense, they have a whole bunch of other smell sensors that they have. Lactic acid, they can sense lactic acid coming. I mean, they have an insane amount of sensors for such a wee little brain they've got. The horizon temperature by your body heat. So they can sense this. And as soon as they sense it, their little, whatever those things are, they start to quiver and shake so that they can actually grab onto you. So they know you're coming. You can't see them. You can't feel them. But they're just waiting, which is why they keep fighting us. And why I say they're smarter than us. So just watch this little guy. This is a tick. This is, I don't know if it's a person, a really hairy person. They wander around for a couple, like for a day or two, trying to find a really good spot to bite. But sometimes they will try to dig in right away. Depends on, you know, I guess how hungry they are or where they landed. But the good thing is, it takes them about 2 hours, even if they decide they like the spot they're in, it takes them about 2 hours to get a really good grip. And in that time, if you take a shower, they rinse them off. So the key thing is, if you're coming in from gardening or doing something, if you take a shower right away, within 2 hours, you'll at least wash away a good number of them. Many of them will wander around for 12 hours, whatever. It really depends on where they live. Got you. Okay, so this is, again, I just want to reinforce that these things are really, really, they've got a lot of survival things going on for them. We can't see them, they see us. We can't feel them bite. They know we're hiding where we can't find them, and they don't come off very easily. So deer ticks, they need a damp, humid environment to survive. They will dry out. They desiccate. So you're not going to find them in a place like in a baseball field or something, or a golf course. If there's dry area, you won't find ticks there. But wooded areas, they love the edge. So if they have like a path and that's the grass, a little bit of grass that comes out on the side, they love going up on that kind of grass. So the night, and they don't hop, they crawl. So you have to actually brush into them. So the good thing about that is, if you're walking or doing something, and you're on a path, and you can either walk and brush up against things, or you can stay in the middle of the path. If you stay in the middle of the path, you are not going to get exposed. It's that simple. And if anytime you're out, just minimize brushing up against things. We actually kind of trail around our property. And just basically clear out the area so that when we can walk in an area without brushing up against it. They're not brushing up against it. They do like to hide in leaves. So the other thing, if you're in your yard, clear out leaf piles. After you're done with that, if you can do a good picture. Ticks are usually picked up on the lower leg. That's where they usually come. Their lower leg, and then they crawl up. So actually, if you wear, I have these wonderfully stylish shoes. I spray them with Permetrin, which you can buy anywhere. Don't have to do it very often. Or you can actually just spray it, because you can do this like once a month. But you can also just spray deep under outside of your shoes and your socks, and that'll probably reduce your chance of getting a tick on you by probably 90-95%, because most of them will be lying. And of course, if you're gardening, you have stuff on the side, if you're brushing into it, mushrooming here, you got real stuff. Deer tick attach to clothing and then walk upward. So the nice thing about you have this Permetrin treated clothing is what I'm wearing, which actually costs about the same, if not less, than the regular, fashionable clothing. You can get it in the fishing department at LOB. My daughter loves it, that I shop in the fishing department. And you can also get it online. It bugs away. There's a couple of other brands. That's pre-treated, and then you can wash it like 40 or 60 times, and it will keep the Permetrin treated. And the thing is, if a tick lands, if I brush into something and you're wearing something like this, the tick does not like Permetrin. It will kill it. So it will drop off. So this is a very nice thing. You don't have to worry about it. This is a point of contact. You're not going to have to worry about it. Now, if you're wearing this regular clothes, it's going to latch on. It's just going to keep crawling up until it finds a nice point of entry, and then it's going to find skin. So you know, really make sure that your clothes are treated.
Is that also true? You have DEET? You can spray
DEET? Yeah, you can spray DEET on the outside of your clothes, yeah.
And the people fall off.
And the DEET, it won't kill them, but it will, you know, but they won't like it, so they'll let go. Yeah, so that's the key thing is your exposure. This I want to go back to this Borrelia miyamotoi. Because what's interesting, you know, before I said that the mice are the cesspool of disease, where where all the diseases sit. With this particular one, it can be passed from the mother tick to the eggs. So this has huge implications because when all look at 2,000 eggs, if there's a diseased tick per 2,000 or 3,000 or 5,000 offspring are all going to be carrying this. That means when those 2,000 little critters go off, they're now going to infect the mouse and whatever. So it's just a whole other opportunity, but it means also that these tiny little six-legged things, which look about the size of a poppy seed, best, those are the cookies on the right. those are actually can be diseased, because up until this point, you would think that those little ones are not diseased. These are, and it's a pretty nasty bug. And again, the peak activity of these larval ticks is in August around here. Okay, so, but again, they don't crawl high; they tend to crawl low. So just watch your feet and socks. Okay, protection. Hiking, play smart, and attention to not brushing up against things if you don't have to. Dress for success. Use repellents. Check for ticks afterwards. Remove ticks correctly and protect your little piece of Eden in your yard. Fashion points. These are things you don't need to do. Section my mind. Section my daughter. but these are again, you know, bugs away. This is I don't have any financial interest in any of this stuff. But you can find this ex officio. They have stuff that's not terribly expensive. You can get you go to LOB. You can find there's a bunch of hunting clothes that are pre-treated. You can get pre-treated from me for this stuff. Yes, pre-treated. The thing is, we're light colors. The reason we're light colors, so if you see a tick crawling up, you can actually see it. We're dark colored, you'll be able to see it. Again, with little tiny ones, you're not going to be able to see them, but with the adult ticks, you can actually see them and remove them. Tuck your shirt into the pants, tuck your pants into it. That way, the ticks don't have a way to get in. And use your repellent on the clothes. A lot of people are afraid of DEET because it's a neurotoxin. It seems like a good reason to be afraid of it. But as far as it's so DEET comes in like different percentages, like 20%, 15%. You only need 15 to 20% to be effective. If you put it on the outside of your clothes, it's not very much of a neurotoxin, as long as you don't like inhale it while you're spraying, which actually is not that difficult to do. There's also something called Napropel, which is pepper-based type of thing. I don't know exactly if it's 100% natural, but it's pretty effective. It's, you know, the studies aren't completely out yet, but it's not a neurotoxin. And then there's some other, there's or London eucalyptus, I'll talk about that. There's one completely natural product. But if you put this on your clothes, you're not really putting yourself at risk. You can actually spray your clothes with DEET. And only put a small amount of whatever else. I use natural gel on my exposed neck or skin or something. And that way you're really, if there's anything not good, it's not you're getting such a low dose. Tick repellents. There's this. Make sure you use something that's EPA registered product for a couple of reasons. Make sure it's not hazardous to our environment. And this is the only natural one that is effective. Oil of lemon eucalyptus. I'm not sure where you buy that. I'm sure if you look online, you can find it. citronella and essential oils are ineffective for ticks. So some things are good for like mosquitoes or other things, but you want to broken it for the ticks. And so anyway, these are the things that work for ticks, and they work pretty well. The thing with DEET, as far as spraying on your clothes, if you have like things in it or like plastics, leather, neoprene, DEET will destroy it. So just, you know, if you're putting on your gear, they don't want to use DEET. But you can put, again, this natural color won't destroy it. So I like the natural color, because you don't have to think, you can just spray it on anything. And these slides will be available if you want to look at any of this. And you only want to just put enough on the color to cover your hair. You don't need to put more on. So that's the thing with, like, you know, if you're using DEET, you don't just put on what you need, or put more than you need. The difference between like the 20% and the 80% DEET is one is supposed to last longer. I think that's the main difference. But you know, you're better off just putting it on when you need it and then you're fine. And the other thing is, I guess we can buy stuff that's like mixture of sunscreen and stuff. Don't do that, because you have to reapply the sunscreen all the time, and you don't want to be reapplying the DEET if you don't need that. The idea is use at the absolute minimum that you need to get the job done, and no more, because it is a neurotoxin. So you want to do tick checks. Tick checks, you know, and just remember where ticks like, you know, moist places. Check your armpits. Check your belly button. And when you shampoo your hair, do check your scalp, because that's where especially when you're hanging out too. But check your scalp. It's not that hard to do. Just when you do a little massage. And if you don't get them the first day, you know, it usually takes a couple of days for them to, you know, infect you. So you have some time, so the first day you may miss them because they're little or they're wandering around, and the second day they might be a little bigger. So you have a little window of time to find them. Removing ticks. I brought spoons for everybody, so everybody can grab a spoon. There's a lot of stuff on the web about using a match or like put Vaseline and like, no, don't do that. First, it doesn't work, and then the thing is the disease actually sits in this part, that's like the back belly of the critter. So if you actually do something like put a match or a pin or do something or squeeze it in the wrong way, you'll actually be basically pressure, you know, squirting the bacteria from the tick body into you. So you'll be self-infected. And even if it is disgusting.
Yeah.
It's disgusting. And that's the other thing, but speaking of disgusting, if you put like I've heard some crazy things, like you're using a match and if you do that, you'll actually really upset the tick, and he'll vomit. He will actually vomit inside you. So not only will you get disease, but you'll get like a cellulitis, you'll get an infection, because you'll be like spitting all this stuff. So you'll actually have a pretty bad wound infection there. So it's really important that if you find a tick on you, don't panic, don't move your dog into the street. If you have tweezers, you know, use that, but use a tick spoon. Now I know you all have one. But just get that spoon, just put it underneath, a little pressure, put it underneath, and then pull up gently. I took a nice tick off of Bob, about a month ago.
It wasn't that nice.
Don't twist. Go right underneath and pull.
Because several years ago, the vet had tick removal tools.
Yeah.
They also had a little fork-like thing, but they had a narrow handle that was meant to twist it.
Yeah. No, don't do that. Because when you twist it, this is for deer tick removal. I don't know about dog ticks. I mean, but the idea is you want to get underneath, pull straight up. When you're twisted, you're going to be squeezing some of the contents into you.
This had like kind of a notch, so the tick wouldn't turn in the notch.
Yeah, well, I mean, as long as you don't turn the notch.
I don't know if it's...
Yeah, well, Well, I'm sure the vet knows how to get something off of a fur.
Well, he was here several years ago. That was
But generally, you don't want to be twisting these jaws. You want to just get underneath, pull straight up, minimize torsion. This is just an example. I use tick spoons to direct them on tick spoons. So here's the other thing. There's a get out of jail free card here. If you're bitten by a tick in an area where it's endemic high risk zone, which is us, if the tick has not been attached for very long, and you'll know that because it's not engorged, okay? If it still looks that pretty bright color, it's not engorged.
What if you are engorged, but the tick
is? If you're engorged, make sure you tick yourself up here. No!
I was bitten in mid-February by a deer tick on my neck, and it was swollen.
Oh, your neck was swollen?
My neck where it bit.
Oh, that's
was like a pimple. I mean, it felt like a pimple in your hurt. I mean, I thought it was a pimple, and it had been there for a couple of days, and so that was swollen, but it when the tick was removed, it didn't look like the tick was engorged.
Oh, okay. Well, you may just have a hypersensitivity. Some people are more sensitive to the tick companion, its little feed, whatever it's called, to you. So that may be a hypersensitivity on your part.
So, and I was sore in that area around my neck.
Yeah.
Is that typical of when
after you remove it, you know, so it's hard to remove everything. You know, they say if you do it right, you remove. I've never been able to remove that completely, or there's always something that's left in. But you know, as long as the thing is not squirting its toxic content into you, you're gonna have something. You'll have a little bit of an area, but your body should be able to handle that, which is why you should basically clean it off. You could put a little antibiotic lotion, but the main thing is just to make sure you clean that site after you've removed that and keep an eye on it. But you can get cellulitis from any kind of skin thing. So I mean, but I don't want to get into that because that could be caused by being bitten by a wasp or a spider or anything else. But the key thing here is whether the tick is engorged. If the tick hasn't been on you for very long, it's not engorged. It's only been on you for say a day or two, and you remove it right away without self-infecting with the tick. If you go to your doctor and you get an antibiotic right away, you can actually prevent Lyme disease. Okay, so that's the thing. So if you find a tick, it's a deer tick, you remove a tick from you. You look around here, and the odds are that tick is infected. Okay. Go contact your doctor right away. You have a very small window in which you can take one pill and you will be cured. Okay? That's a very nice thing. and you may have to educate your doctor about this. You can tell me a little advice and you want to crazy talk. But this is appropriate medical practice in areas where your Lyme disease is endemic.
There's no rash, and the doctor says there's no rash, and you don't have Lyme.
You wouldn't have a rash yet. And this is within 2-3 days after. So the tick, you just took the tick off. You're not going to see a rash then. If there is anything, I mean, at that point, you're not going to see a rash.
So the doctor doesn't know whether you actually.
It's a clinical diagnosis. It would be acute Lyme disease. None of the